Thank you everyone for coming today. Thank you Adorama for having us. I just wanted to introduce some amazing women today. We wanted to discuss some women in photojournalism because the industry is largely led by men and we never had a huge all women amazing kick-ass panel before. So let's give it up to the women today. We're just going to be discussing a little bit about our stories, a little bit about our work, and just kind of telling you guys how we live, survive, and kind of like kill it in New York City. It's a hard city to live in. It's a hard world to live in, and I think we're all doing pretty well considering. So let's just start. I'm going to start with Brigitte Stelzer. All right. All right, Brigitte Stelzer is a native-born Austrian. She came to America in 1986 to pursue her dreams in the world of photography. She started working for several Austrian magazines as a U.S. correspondent in Los Angeles, taking on freelance assignments. She was versatile in her work, ranging from children's portraits, shooting, and designing set cards for models and actors, and led assisted photographers for Playboy magazine. She went on to cover many editorial news for The Hollywood Reporter, Business Week magazine. After freelancing for many years, she joined the New York Post in 1997, where she has distinguished herself as a news editorial features photographer. Her photographs appear all around the world in print and online publications. She leads the New York Post in breaking news, celebrities, social, and investigative journalism. And we have... Okay. All right. Jennifer Altman on the very end. She is an award-winning photojournalist who specializes in editorial, reportage, environmental, celebrity portraiture, corporate, and commercial work. She is a regular contributor to the New York Times, the LA Times, the Boston Globe, the Washington Post, the US Today, the United Nations, Barron's Magazine, Business Week, American Express, MetLife, and her work has been published in numerous and other domestic and international publications. She has been a photo editor who has worked on special projects with UNICEF, the AP, and several other newspapers. She also serves on the board of trustees for the New York Press Photographers Association since 2008. Her work has been on many exhibits in galleries and museums. Jennifer Altman is an adjunct professor at photojournalism at the CUNY Graduate School of Photojournalism in 2013, teaching photojournalism classes and developing workshops. We have Katie Orlinsky sitting right next to Jennifer Altman. Katie Orlinsky, whoops, let's start your stuff. Okay, Katie Orlinsky is a photographer and cinematographer from New York City. She received a bachelor's degree in political science and Latin American studies from Colorado College and a master's degree in journalism from Columbia University. Katie's held long-held interest in international politics and a desire to raise awareness on social issues originally led her to photography, and after college she moved to Mexico, where she got her start as a photojournalist. Since then, Katie's photographed personal projects, assignments, documentaries all over the world. Katie regularly works at the New York Times, the New Yorker, the Wall Street Journal, Al Jazeera America, and a variety of international magazines and nonprofits such as Too Young to Wed, an organization and campaign to end child marriage around the world. She has won numerous awards such as the 2014 ADC Young Guns Award, the 2013 PDN 30s New and Emerging Photographers to Watch, and the Alexia Foundation in 2012 Student Grant, and the 2011 POYI Emerging Vision Incentive Award, the 2000 Prix Annie Pix Palace, and the 2009 Coup de Cour at Vice pour l'Image. Thanks a lot for all that. Man. All right. And Nancy Berwick. She is sitting right next to Brigitte. All right. Nancy Berwick is a documentary photographer currently based in New York. She is a graduate from the Documentary Photography and Photojournalism Program at ICP, International Center Photography, not Insane Clown Posse, and holds a degree in anthropology from Union College. Over the previous 10 years, Nancy narrowed her focus of work, telling her stories of illness and personal relationships, using compassion, humility, and trust as tools to connect with and explore the lives of her subjects. Nancy's most recent focus has been her parents' battle with cancer. Nancy is a regular contributor to the New York Times, Newsday, Corbis, and her work has also been featured in International Herald Tribune, the New York Times, Lens Blog, CNN, National Geographic Proof, Time Magazine, Photo District News, The Washington Post, Newsweek Japan, and Feature Shoot. She was recently awarded the Arnold Newman Prize in New Directions in Photographic Portraiture and received the Eddie Adams Workshop Award in Innovation in Visual Storytelling. Her cancer family, an ongoing project, was exhibited in the Visa pour l'Image in Perpignan, France in 2015 and was shown in shots and works at the Look 3 Photography Festival in Virginia. She was named one of the 2013 Magenta Foundation Flash Forwarding Emerging Photographers, and Berwick participated in the second annual New York Portfolio Review, sponsored by the New York Times Lens Blog. In 2014, Berwick was named one of the best of ASMP featured photographers, as well as one of Lens Culture's top 50 emerging talents. Welcome, ladies. All right. So we're just going to begin just kind of talking about a little bit of stories. We're going to get into everyone's work slowly by just different types of moments in our lives and different types of crime scenes up to celebrities. So let's start with Jennifer. Jennifer. Let me find my notes. What moments in your career that really helped you become the driven and talented photographer that you are today? You're a mother of two, you're a freelancer, you've been in the city as a native New Yorker your whole life. You've been pretty much killing it since the age of 18 as a photographer. And we have been doing everything from crime scenes to celebrities to portraiture. How do you jump from subject to subject? So for instance, you mentioned one time you're at a crime scene, and then 5 hours later, you had to go shoot a celebrity. Yeah. So let's discuss the story about when you got the assignment for the crime scene, and I'll show the slides.
So should we wait till the slides start and then
start? Go.
So basically, this was a scene on 125th Street in Harlem, and I was on assignment for the New York Times. Can you guys hear me? Okay. Basically, it was a shop, like an electrical appliance shop, that was getting robbed, and two guys went in there and tried to. Okay. Thanks. Sorry. Two guys went in there and were going to rob the shop, but the owner had a gun, and he ended up killing them instead. So I was assigned after to go check out the scene, and that day, later in the afternoon, I actually went to a celebrity portrait, which totally changed my mindset. It's probably not an easy thing to do, but all of our talents kind of work the same way, where we can, you know, assess the situation and figure out the humanity of it and pursue that. So.
These images that you're reviewing right now is from the crime scene, and it seems like you got into like three or four different, completely different angles. You got really close to the actual scene itself. You saw the guy who was actually assaulted. You see the man being covered up. It seems like you were pretty much all over the place.
That was one of the robbers, actually.
This one was?
Yeah. And the last picture in the loop is the owner of the shop. So, yeah, it was... when I first got there, I was like, how am I going to get in there, basically, because all the streets are closed off and, you know, you're not supposed to be there. So I went into a building next door, which happened to be a church, and then I went up to the rooftop and climbed over another rooftop and then got that overhead picture, and then just ran around kind of like a maniac for a while, and then eventually I went into the store after, like, the police had left and hung around for a little bit and was speaking to the guy, and he said that he never thought that his day would go like that, basically. And I hope that the pictures kind of show that. But then I ran downtown to do a celebrity portrait, which totally makes you reevaluate your life a little bit and your day, you know, like how you don't expect your day to go the way it is either. No.
So pretty much from shooting a dead man on the street, you're back hustling and shooting celebrities and
dragging 100 pounds of lights.
Yeah.
And, you know, going into some random theater and lighting an actor and then trying to have his essence come out too. But, you know, you're a person, right? So obviously what just happened kind of affected my view of the day. So we started out talking about that, which, you know, most celebrities think that you think that you're one step removed from them in a way, like, but they're all just regular people, and you're like, how was your day? And then you say, oh, well, my day was a little crazy, actually. And then, you know, get the essence of the person as you're having your conversation, basically.
It really seems like you humanize everybody, whether they're dead or alive, right?
I hope so.
Okay.
Part of the job, right?
And you also, you say you just hang out with the celebrities, you have a really rapport, and you just kind of treat them like normal people.
Yeah, I think that when you do a lot of celebrity portraiture, you know, a lot of people think they have this diva quality to them, but they really just want to be treated like everybody else. So you go in and you say, you know, what'd you do this morning? How's your, you know, what are you up to this afternoon? How's your job going? Like everybody else. And then they kind of come out to you, and, you know, you want to find the essence of that person. And so it's all about being real and, you know, not being swayed by their stardom, I think. And that has served me well, at least.
And because of that, you get shots just like this with Usher, where you're just pretty much hugging him. Get that shot. How did you get this shot?
So this shot is actually a reflection in a mirror that I had lit him from the side and another side. And then I kind of talk to the celebrities when, you know, I have an idea in mind and see how to kind of execute it. So we kind of work together sometimes. Sometimes they like a little direction, which is good, and then it makes my job good too. So basically I'm standing right underneath his elbow, because that's how you have to get that kind of shot and compress it and then have it reflected back in the mirror. And I thought about it as, I thought it was kind of cool, actually, when I saw it. And I thought, how am I going to do that now? You know, so, I mean, we really only have like 10 minutes with these people, too. So to work like that and, you know, get various scenarios out of each session, I would call it, is one of my specialties. And, you know, just trying to go in 15 minutes before, a half hour before, light the room. I go into some random hotel room or wherever, and then think about what's going to look the coolest, and then just try and draw out the person and have their humanity come forward. And I think, you know, it's all about them being natural and comfortable, and a lot about good portraiture is the rapport of the photographer with the subject, and not making them feel like they're on the spot, sort of, but letting them have their moments.
We're definitely going to come back to this, right?
Sure.
So we're just going to move a little ahead towards Brigitte. Brigitte, you also have a very similar lifestyle. You've been hustling, you do crime scenes, you shoot celebrities, you do everything and above every single day, even to the point that your hand is now broken because she shoots too much. So let's discuss just a little bit about how you achieve photos. And let's just go into Naomi Campbell. Going to go from celebrity to celebrity, but this is a much different story.
I think it was about 8 years ago. I don't really remember exactly what year it was, when Naomi Campbell in Manhattan in her apartment just threw the cell phone towards her housekeeper because she was mad at her.
2006.
And it was just one of those days, you know, as a photojournalist, when you start at 8 o'clock in the morning, you never know where you're going to end up the next hour. And that is actually the excitement that that job brings with it. because you meet so much and see so much and learn so much. And at this point, I just raced down to Park Avenue to get her walking with the NYPD to be questioned at the precinct. And then found out from my photo desk that the housekeeper was transported to Lenox Hill Hospital. So I chased down to Lenox Hill, parked my car. Just thought, you know what, if I go inside before any other the media is here, just take a little point and shoot. And my pocketbook, and I just go inside and look for a woman that has a head injury. Obviously, the cell phone was landing on the head, so there's got to be blood. I went to the x-ray, and I saw a woman, which was a Hispanic lady, and she was in a wheelchair. And at this point, I knew what she was and what she looked like. I went to the emergency room a half an hour later and found her. And I introduced myself, and I spoke to her, and I said that I'm really sorry what happened to her. I kind of like basically... You know, I earned her trust. We've been talking to her for 15 minutes and why I'm here. And she said to me, that is okay, I like that. And I like to give you something. And she reaches out right next to her bed and she gives me a plastic bag with a coat inside. And that is actually the picture that I've taken, gotten the bloody coat with the words Naomi Campbell on it, because she has all her maids wearing coats with her name on it. She also asked me to take her photo, but just from the side. She was scared. She wanted me to hide her face, and so I did. I went outside and just went to my car, innocently not speaking to any of my colleagues across the street, hoping nobody realizes or recognizes me. I, you know, took off with my car, went about 5 blocks, sent that picture via laptop from the computers to my paper, which is the New York Post, that I'm gladly worked for since 1997. And that picture sold all over the world within 5 days. And that was the exclusive that we had. And that is an excitement that I have to achieve those moments if you can, obviously being very careful and staying ethical. But that's just an amazing achievement when you have a situation like this that nobody else has at that time. And it just goes around and it speaks the story. It's always that one photo that just tells you the story, and that's all you needed. That's the story.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Brigitte, we also have another interesting tale to tell. You like burglars, apparently. You like to capture your moments. Please explain.
So once again, this is one of those unexpected moments that you really do not know. You have no idea what's coming your way the next minute. So about 3 weeks ago, just before my surgery on my hand, I got a call from my photo desk to go on a level one mobilization on Lexington Avenue because there was a burglary in a very rich high-rise apartment building, and to just take pictures and see what's going on. I went there. We had NYPD, we had emergency service unit, we had K-9 dogs. They roamed that entire building. That's about, I really don't know, I think it was about 15 floors high. They roamed everything. They couldn't find thief. They took off. They were done with their search. And I got a call from my desk to stay there and find the victim with my reporter colleague. So we had to stand outside on the sidewalk in front of the main entrance to the building and kind of try to find out what unit was affected by that burglar and what's the woman's or guy's name or not, and if we can maybe get a hold of that person. Well, I was standing there for about 3 hours. The doorman goes to the door and locks it from the inside. And I'm looking and I'm like, what is he doing? At the same second, right next to that door, there's a door that rips open and a guy chases out of that door. The doorman screams, that's him, that's him. I'm like, wait a second, that's him? Oh my God, no, I gotta run. I gotta run and get a picture for the Post. I have to take a picture of the burglar. So I'm taking this photo, as you see, you know, with the gray coat and the green bag, and he's running. And I'm running and I'm losing sight of him and I'm screaming and yelling at everybody, stop him, he's a thief, you gotta stop him. You know, the black guy with the red shirt? And I'm screaming, everybody's looking at me like, she's crazy. So, I'm running a block and a half, and I gave up kind of for standing on the corner thinking, damn, he's gone. And I'm going across the street, and I'm going back towards that building, and I still ask everybody, black man, red shirt, black man, red shirt. And this guy, yeah, that guy there, he's over there. Oh, my God, I'm running towards that. It was a courtyard with some bushes and trees, and I'm seeing somebody move behind some bushes, and I'm running towards there, aiming my camera. And the guy sees me and runs away. He had changed his clothes, left the green bag behind, jumped on a 15-foot wall, turned towards me for one shot that I got out of my elbow, and then he was gone. But 2.5 or 3 hours later, the police got him, and he was you know, transported out in handcuffs, and I got that picture as well. But doing this for so many years, that was the first time that I got a burger before he was arrested, so that was a pretty exciting day. And that's the
story.
You
did the cop's job for them.
Thank you. You're welcome.
And Nancy, you also have hustled too on breaking news as well. Obviously, everybody knows last year we had this huge explosion down on 2nd Avenue, and Nancy was right there, right in the middle of it. Let's discuss that.
Okay, so I had heard on the news that a building had exploded, and I actually lived down the block from where the explosion was. So I grabbed my gear, my computer, everything, and I booked it because I knew as soon as I got there, there were going to be police and firemen everywhere who would immediately start pushing you away. So as soon as I got there, you know, I saw the police and the firemen, but everyone was lost in the chaos, and I thought, okay, I can get lost in this chaos too. And I found a door that was someone had propped open around the corner, and I went up and I met a couple people that were working in the building, and they actually, I looked out their window, I couldn't see much, and I asked if I could get access to their roof. So I ran up there, and I was really surprised, actually. I got up there, and nobody was up there. You know, like when you're a news shooter, you're always kind of looking up to see a good vantage point, and usually you see another photographer already there. So I got up to the roof, I started shooting, and I remember I called the New York Times and was like, and I, at this point, I hadn't really been shooting breaking news for them, but I called the photo desk and was like, I'm on a rooftop, I'm photographing the explosion, nobody's here yet. Can I be on assignment? Can I send you these photos? And they were like, excuse me, what? Like, Nancy Borwick? Oh, sure, yeah, okay. And I sent them in, and I ended up staying up there all day. Some of my favorite photos were actually at the end of the night when everybody had left, because one of the challenges you face in these situations is power, computer power, not having access to outlets, and everybody's computers and everyone's cameras were running out of battery. So people were starting to disappear once other reporters and photographers were leaving, once they really got their photographs and their story. And I stuck around a little later, and the light, a magic thing happens, you know, as photographers, you know, when it gets dark out and there's smoke and you have police lights. So the sky was pink, and it made for really beautiful images. And I just remember calling into the desk being like, I have 6% battery. I can't caption these. They're transmitting now. Let me know when you get them, and I can like speak the caption to you. And they're like, all right, awesome. you have to make it happen.
I made it on the Times.
Oh, and that's what ended up running the next day.
A full page.
Yeah, that was a cool.
Great.
I also learned it's important to, you know, if you're running towards a scene, especially a fire, to plan a little bit better. Like I might have had my scarf with me, but I, you know, the direction of the wind changed and all the smoke just started flying towards myself and the other photographers, and you just sort of have to be prepared for anything. And of course, like that morning, I think I was like editing like a headshot, and I wasn't planning on covering, you know, an explosion, so I didn't, you know, I learned my lesson about that. And maybe a battery charger.
A backup charger, right?
A backup charger.
Definitely.
Actually, one funny thing, when I was doing that other murder scene, I was the first one on the rooftop, and so the other photographers were downstairs, and they were like, you know?
Yeah. Well, I think I assume that, like, I mean, I think people are always looking. I'm always looking up, and if I see someone, I'm like, oh, I have to get up there, too.
Yeah, they need to get up there. Exactly.
Yeah.
Do you guys ever have any duking out the best shot vantage point from photographers? Do you guys have any like kind of tense moments in those kind of situations if you do find yourself in the same situation as other photographers and reporters? Or do you guys have a better relationship on the scene?
I think everybody's pretty friendly on the scene. Everybody wants everybody to get the shot.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So it's a big community once you guys are on the scene, right? Everyone like helps each other out and...
Yeah,
to an extent.
It's to an extent.
Right? You know, you have to remember newspapers have a competition, and it's always about what paper has the best photo and sells the highest circulation on it. So that is what we are based on as well. So you always have to be careful who you can trust and who you can't. which is part of being a photojournalist on the New York streets, because you get to know everyone in and out. You know the ones that like to stab you in the back and the ones that love to help you. So it's always different. Every situation is different. But, you know, of course, every one of the photographers wants to be the big star and stick out and be the best. I mean, this is always the first fights that we do, who gets the first photo, the best shot, the best, fastest way. Because now it's a competition with the website. Since we have social media, the photo's got to be out within an hour. You know, you don't have 5 hours for deadline. You got to send it now. So there's that.
But there's also a part of the community where, like, you know, I remember the first breaking news story I ever did. I missed... We were waiting for 8 hours to see if they were going to find anything, like the body of Eitan Peitz, I believe it was. And it was my first breaking news. I was so excited. I was so nervous. And I was watching and waiting. And after about 8 hours, I think I was a little off my game. And I didn't realize it, but the police, the representative showed up. And everyone ran over to circle around him and photograph him. He was making an announcement, and I was like 5 steps behind everyone because I was like looking at my phone. I was terrified, you know, because you can't not send in a photograph. You can't be like, oh, sorry, I missed it. So I remember another female photographer was there, and we had spoken a couple of times, and she had gotten her shots, and she was, at that point, wasn't really shooting, and was kind of, I saw her looking for a way out, and I kind of nudged her, and I was like, any chance, because she knew I was new also, and I was like, any chance I could sneak in there, and she let me in, and I remembered that, because we crossed paths again in the future, and I was able to help her, and it's knowing who you can trust, knowing who you can't trust, and really, you know, being a good journalist and being smart. You got to be smart.
You know, you create your own world out there as you start from day one. Yeah. Whoever, you know, you give in, you be part of it, you be compassionate, you listen, you look around you, and you help. And that help helps and gives you back in all these years afterwards, because people don't forget.
It comes around.
Exactly, yeah.
But on the other hand, you know, like when you're in the pack, I always go away from the pack after a while, because the pack travels together, and so they're all getting the same shot, and you need to differentiate yourself. And mm-hmm. sometimes it's that other shot that's better, you know. Definitely. So you have to work it, basically.
You always have to see everyone else's eyes as well as your own.
Well, and sometimes because of that, like I remember thinking, I was like, okay, maybe there's a way I can get a different shot, because I totally screwed myself. Right. But it's good. You learn from those lessons. Yeah, absolutely.
Yes. All right, we're going to move to Nancy. Nancy, this is her personal project that she's been working on. Well, she worked on for many years. Nancy, both of your parents passed away from cancer. It was a very, speak up. It was a very kind of hard and emotional time for you, obviously. But you also had a camera with you at the same time. A lot of people put that camera down at that moment, and a lot of people keep the camera on at that moment. You kept it on from the beginning to the end, pretty much. And you had moments that you yourself were weak and a little... it's hard to have an emotional place that you're in and also shoot at the same time. So I just want to talk about your favorite image of your parents, and also then another moment in your life that we can discuss. And then we'll go for the whole series.
Okay. I hope everyone can hear me. This is one of my favorite photographs of my parents. My mom, she was in treatment for stage 4 breast cancer, metastatic breast cancer, and my father was also in treatment for cancer, stage 4 pancreatic cancer. So I started photographing my parents really as a way to spend time with them. I would go home every week, be there with them, help however they needed, talk to doctors, drive them, whatever. I also realized I didn't know how much time I had left with them. But by being there, I also realized I needed to be strong, and I didn't know if I could be what they needed unless I protected myself in some way. And I didn't realize this until after the fact, but I was really using my camera as a way to understand what they were going through, but also in some ways maybe distance myself a little bit. I felt like there were moments, like in this moment, I remember thinking, wow, like the light looks beautiful. Like I had these moments of with my photographer hat on, being like, you know, like, look how that light is. It's, I knew it would be have that contrast. And also, I think the reason why I really like this photograph is it, a moment earlier, they had been showing me their porta-caths. They both had scars and where they were getting their chemotherapy put in. And about a moment after that, my dad just kind of like swept in and hugged my mom tight. And they, in some way, I felt like they kind of even resembled each other. And there was this unity and vulnerability. I just, whenever I look at it, I just feel that connection back to that moment. Yeah.
I think everyone does. It's very powerful.
Thanks.
And Nancy, you also had some moments yourself in the same time period.
Whoops. So people always ask me, like, how could you have been able to do this and, like, not completely lose it? And there were very few moments, I think, that I didn't have my camera on my shoulder. I feel like, especially as a news photographer, you never know when something's going to happen, especially if you're on assignments. You always are looking around, and you're always ready to shoot something. And the same went for my project, my story on my family. And I was in the hospital with my parents for the 100th time, making photographs. And I just decided, you know, like, I've seen this scene before. I just wasn't in the mood. So I put my camera down. And I was watching the nurse as she tried to find a vein strong enough to give my dad an IV. And she was struggling. And I was watching her. And the next thing I knew, I was being walked into another room and laid and put on a bed. And I guess I've never fainted before, but I think I was starting to faint. And a nurse took me into the other room. And I had this moment of, like, how come this is happening now? And I had this realization that I think it was that moment, the first time really, that I wasn't using my camera as I was experiencing this reality with my parents. So this photograph was taken actually, well, obviously not by me, but while I was laying there, I heard giggling and I was like, what's going on? And my mom came around the corner and she had my camera and took a picture of me and was giggling and was like, ha ha ha, how the tables have turned. And that was actually, it made me really happy. I mean, obviously I'm like rolling my eyes at her there, but it made me happy that she was engaging back with me. Sometimes, you know, when you're working with subjects, I like to think that it's a collaboration, like Jennifer was saying, and that's sort of how it was. I like to think that's how it was with my parents, because I was trying to tell our story and their story, and it was important that they, as my key characters, you know, could have a role, have other roles, and have say in what I was shooting and what I wasn't.
Thanks so much. Now we're also going to see her whole project, just because it's so powerful, and something is definitely to be said that the fact that you documented both of your parents at the same time, I think everybody in this whole room was commending you for your strength and your fierceness and your beauty in all of it. So let's enjoy. But Nancy, please, if you want to continue talking about it, that's totally fine, or we could just run it through, however you feel.
Talk us through it, Nancy.
Talk us through it. All right.
I'll talk you through it. So I actually think in some ways being an assignment shooter, it really prepared me for this project. I remember walking into this situation and my mind wasn't going towards, oh, those were my parents hooked up to chemo machines, having poison pumped through them. It was, wow, look at that composition and look at that symmetry. And that's really where my brain went. And I think by being in practice and covering different types of assignments, I think that helped prepare me. So I was spending a lot of time with my parents, going home every week. They lived about an hour north of here, and just started photographing their life. And I realized pretty quickly that the story was not so much about their disease, it was about their relationship and about life and what happens when these are the cards that you're dealt. My parents were pretty amazing. They both went through the process of dealing with, you know, the day-to-day treatment of the disease, but also trying to care for each other, and deal with their own feelings of their own mortality, and that struggle was pretty amazing. They were also very, very open with me. I sort of demanded transparency, that if I was going to be there and I was going to be helping them and trying to really tell their story, I needed them to be open and honest with me. And I can imagine as, I can't imagine, but a daughter asking parents that, it was hard for my parents to really let that guard down, but they did. And that allowed me into their world. And just to, another thing that I realized in this process was, when you're working on a story like this, it's important, and we all know this, that you really need to spend time with your subjects. I had been going home once a week for one or two days, because that's all I could really navigate at the time. And things were happening that I didn't even know about on the days that I wasn't there. So I, you know, instead of, my parents aren't going to, you know, weren't going to call me and say, hey, we're cutting off mom's hair today. Like, are you coming up? Like, no. So I made a point to be up there a lot. And all the while, I got married. Photographers always think this is kind of funny. This is a photograph that I took at my wedding. As you can see, I'm right there front and center, but I also had climbed a tree earlier that day and rigged a camera with a remote trigger. And I had this plan. I was going to walk down the aisle with the trigger in my bouquet and just, you know, set it off while I walked down the aisle. And I had this moment of clarity where I thought, wow, I feel like my husband wouldn't appreciate that. Like, in this one moment, like, I'm working our wedding. I know, it's so hard to turn it off. So what I did, and hard to relinquish that control. So what I did is I set everything up and I handed the remote off to a colleague of mine, another photographer, and she triggered it. And I have to tell you, standing under the chuppah, hearing the shutter go off, and it was ever so slight, but like I could hear it. I just like felt so good.
Like, it's being captured.
It was, yeah. And we got something like that. Pretty quickly, about 2.5 weeks after the wedding, my dad was jaundiced, and we had to take him to the hospital. And it turned out that his tumor, his pancreatic cancer, is one of the bad ones. One of the worst ones, and his tumors had been pushing on his bile duct, and it was a series of events that really was where he started to turn. And I definitely struggled photographing this because it just didn't seem real to me. That's the thing. I couldn't believe these were my parents. And maybe in some ways, not believing that, like, also allowed me to photograph it, because I was, again, like, looking, I saw this gesture, and I thought, wow, this was 5 minutes after, 5 minutes after he got his DNR bracelet. You know, it was decided that he wasn't going to be resuscitated if he died. And, like, there he was, sort of, it was out of our control, out of his control. And I just remember taking this photograph and sitting down and just being in disbelief. But, you know, like, I think my parents were both very, they were very open about their story and their experience, and encouraged me. There were moments that, like, I wasn't necessarily even thinking of photographing, and they'd be like, oh, you're not photographing this? but then pretty soon after my dad had gone to the hospital, he passed away. And as a photographer photographing this journey, I thought, you know, I want to have a photograph from the funeral. You're always trying to tell as much of the story as you can in one frame, get as much context in one frame. And I knew that everyone in that audience was part of the story. My, you know, friends, family from his entire life, and there he was, front and center. So I knew I was going to want that. But I also, I don't know if you guys do this, but before I go on any shoot, I can't help but start to picture all of my dream photographs. Like, oh, this is definitely one I'll want, or I'm hoping this situation happens because this is what I would want to do. And it just, like, your wheels start turning. And so before the funeral, I thought, okay, I'm going to go in before anyone's there, look at what the shot would look like, and just set it in my mind so that when I get up there, I don't actually have to think about it, because I didn't know how I would be. And honestly, when I got up there for the eulogy, I wasn't you know, I was in tears and I was frozen, and I told the audience what I was doing, and I stepped away from the bima to take the photograph, and it was obviously silent. And I was, it was terrifying, but also really comforting because I knew everyone there. So, and so it was important in my mind at this point. I was telling a story and I was telling their story, so I had to have that photograph. My dad was also kind of, it was, I think a big part of getting through this for my family was that we looked to humor in this process that also helped me photograph it. My dad was not one of tradition, which the rabbi reminded me when I asked about the funeral service, and my dad wanted to be buried in his favorite Giants jersey, which is not tradition. And that was, and also in Jewish tradition, you don't usually see inside the casket. And I understand why. It's pretty terrifying. There's no embalming, but also it made us really happy to see that, which might sound crazy, like my father laying there, but there was closure, and I did what I knew what to do in that moment, which was to take a photograph. Like, obviously looking back, I'm like, maybe I could have done it a little differently, whatever. I let myself off the hook. Of course, after my dad passed away, my mom was still sick, and I still went home and spent time with her, because now she's living alone, taking care of herself, going to treatments, trying to live life after so many years. I think they were married, they were married 34 years, and now for the first time in those 34 years, she was single, essentially, and on her own, and had to sort of, was forced to now focus on what she was going through and not necessarily take care of my dad. Having my dad around gave her an excuse to not deal with the reality of what she was experiencing. So this was the first birthday, her first birthday after my dad passed away. I dragged her out to do some pottery, and unfortunately, the black and white, you miss this, but she didn't like to be in public. She felt like she stood out. So I thought, why don't we both stand out? You know, this was a moment where I was thinking like a daughter, and I picked up these, like, neon wigs, and she was wearing a neon pink wig. I was wearing purple, and we went out and like painted pottery. And this was actually a day there was a building collapse in Harlem. And I remember very vividly, like, seeing all the updates, getting all, it was really hard because it had happened that morning and I'd already planned to go up to see my mom. And I had this moment of, you know, like everybody, the pack was all going, everybody was shooting that. It was a big deal. And I felt that, like, that pain of, like, knowing that I needed to be there. But at the same time, when you go through something like this or you work on a personal project, you get some real perspective. Maybe in the same way when you photograph a crime scene and then you're photographing a celebrity later in the day, you have this perspective about the world that, like, maybe what's important to you, or you, it just, it pushes you to think, pushed me to think more about what was, at the end of the day, the news would be covered by excellent journalists and I would have spent the day with my mom and I would be okay with that. So that was hard for me, but obviously, like, this was more important. So my mom started to struggle, and it was strange. It was around the same, like, pretty much the same time the following year after my dad, when he was jaundiced. It was around the time that she started to really have trouble. You know, she had been sick for 18 years on and off with cancer, so we kind of thought she would live forever, probably also with cancer, but, like, you know, she'd done it this long. But she was really starting to struggle. And this photograph I took the day I came home. I was on assignment in Buffalo. There was a big snowstorm. And I stayed a couple extra days to shoot. And then while I was up there, I remember I was, like, so busy focusing on that I got a call from probably my sister, I think. And she told me that the oncologist had come to our house and that mom was starting hospice. And there I was in snowy Buffalo, like, photographing snow. And that was another moment where I was like, I called my editors and I was like, I think we have everything we need. And they're like, yeah. And I'm like, all right, I'm flying home. And I went home right away and went upstate to my mom's. And for about 2 weeks, that was the 20th, 3 weeks, I was home, Thanksgiving, Hanukkah. It was very strange. It was very deja vu. And at this point, I was having a really hard time photographing. It was suddenly settling in how real it was, especially because I was so shocked that my mom was struggling the way she was, that I was having a hard time photographing her. So I started doing the thing where you avoid and you photograph details and you photograph like blurry windows. I just didn't know how to express what I was feeling, but I needed to keep shooting because I, and it becomes such a part of the process of grieving and healing and all of that for me. And our home sort of became this weird space where people were coming and going. And this was the morning, this was the first morning my mom didn't get out of bed. It was strange. I don't remember the situation all that well in the moment. And I look at the photographs and it brings me back in a good way. Cause a lot of really beautiful things happened in that time. I think in many ways we honor birth and life and we hide from death and we don't want to talk about it. We don't want to see it. And she lived such a beautiful life and she should have a beautiful death. Like her memory should not be about this gruesome death. It should be about like the person she was, and she should leave this earth the way she came. And I've had a lot of those moments just understanding what happened. But and things just changed really quickly. And these are a few photographs right after she passed away. It was so surreal, and I kept shooting because I was like, this isn't real, this isn't happening. But I also knew I needed to take the photograph again. I told his story, and I wanted to tell her story, and I love my parents equally, so of course I wanted that. And there was this sense of deja vu that I was feeling, so I was thinking that if I shot the same image that it would hopefully translate that feeling that I had. Almost the same image. I actually am very annoyed with myself because it's a little bit different. And when I side by side compare them, I'm like, ugh, why wasn't I thinking more clearly when I did that? But again, I let myself off the hook. My mom requested that I not photograph her in the casket, open casket. And you know, when a subject expresses that kind of wish in that kind of situation, I feel it's important to honor that. So I found another way to take that picture. And so now, the anniversary, I didn't mention this, but my father had passed away on December 7th, 2013. My mom passed away on December 6th, 2014. So it was just shy of a year, one day shy of a year. The anniversary was last weekend. And one of the really beautiful things that came out of this project was around the time of my wedding, the piece was published in the New York Times. And while both of my parents were alive, they got to see the impact that photography could have because people were contacting us from around the world, thanking us for sharing and telling us their stories. And, you know, we were just like a regular family, and this was, you know, the situation we were in. And that was really encouraging to me, just to, I think as a photographer and as a photojournalist, you hope and wish that people care about the story as much as you do, and you hope and wish that it helps bring change in some way or awareness. And when you get to see that happen in real time, it's amazing. It's encouraging. It makes you want to do more. But then and then when it's happening with your family, it's especially confusing because it's your personal life and your professional life. But I actually think that my whole process of grieving has been very unique and very gentle and supported because I've never been alone. I've had the photo community and the world just like supporting me. So it's changed my life. And I appreciate you. I get to share it here.
Thank you so much for sharing. All right. So we're going to move to Jennifer, where we're going to speak another similar story, but a little different level. Jennifer, do you want to just intro your Angelica story for us?
I have to follow that, which was insane, but wonderful, really wonderful. So this project that I is presenting, it's a multimedia project, so you'll hear audio overlay over it from the main subject, and it's about a girl named Angelica Gutierrez who has childhood cancer. We worked together on and off for about 4 years, though we took off about a year
when she had went into remission because she wanted to, and then when it came back, she wanted to start the project again. So we did that. You know, it was different for me because it's a different. This was not my family, but I felt very close to her. And I mean, you can watch it, and we could talk about it after, I guess. Right?
Sounds good.
Okay.
Stand by.
It's not.
Oh, there it was.
Okay. It's not my place for me to ask God why, because it's something I'm given and it's something I have to deal with, and it's something that I have to make into a positive thing, as difficult as it is. I have non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. It's a blood cancer that you develop in your, primarily in your lymph nodes. And my first diagnosis was in 2003. I was 16 and turning 17 that same year. I'm not gonna say it wasn't hard. I got through it, and eventually my hair started growing back. I got better, was able to start eating, and things were getting to normal. And I started school in September, and then was diagnosed again. Right now, this is the third time I've been on treatment. Days when I have my dark sides and I'm depressed, and you're supposed to, I guess, even though people say always remain positive, there are days when I'm not, like, I can't, you know, I'm like, screw this, like, what the hell, I'm 20 years old and, like, what did I do? I don't want to be hesitant saying that, but sometimes you're like, I don't want to live in fear. When I was not diagnosed, I still was scared. The psychiatrist at the hospital says, it's like you have this sword above you that's like barely hanging on to a thin string, and you're always going to be scared of it. I live for what I can see in the future, to see, be a part of my family and be a part of the lives of the people that I love and the connections that I've made with people. So I don't know, I fight to live.
Next message.
I'm sorry to hear that Grandma, she passed away last night. You get the number. Kevin has cell phone number if you want to call. Carrie has cell with me. She had a heart failure, and fortunately this cancer took over, so I know that she was fond of you a lot. If I can get in touch, then maybe we'll talk later. Okay, again, this is everyone in Jericho's mother. Bye.
End of message.
Sometimes I feel guilty that because of what I'm going through, everybody else has to go through something. Bye. Oh, I never say bye until we talk again.
We'll be very soon.
Gets me every time.
Yes.
Jen and Nancy, you guys both went through some very powerful stuff with these two projects, but they both have very similar, nerve endings, and a lot of things are very similar but very different. I loved how you guys both documented two very hard stories to document in two separate, totally different ways. And I just want to see what you guys think about each other's projects.
So actually, before we came here, I watched what I thought was going to be the video that was played to prepare myself, and I watched a different video. So
you
that
did.
Yeah, so that was a different video than I had seen.
Oh. Wow.
I'm really glad, because now I'm experiencing this for the first time. You know, I related to a lot of what she was saying and what she was going through, mm-hmm. and I commend you. Especially, I know that you have children, right?
I do. Yes.
I guess as a mother and as a journalist, and to just be there with her, and to show her I like how you showed the full story, you know, with cancer and or you know with disease and without disease, but it seemed like she didn't want it to define her. And you didn't photograph it like it defined her. And so I felt her joy and her youthfulness. And I think that was really beautiful. I'm still processing. So that's all I can say right now.
Yeah, she would have liked that, actually. Yeah. I started out the project by meeting her through this bedside educator in the hospitals. Where the children have cancer, there's educators who come in and teach them. And I was on an assignment for the Times, actually, doing some sporting event at the hospital. Not a sporting event, but somebody came to visit the kids kind of thing. And I saw that going through, there was this little square through the door, and I saw this woman teaching this, other woman, this girl rather, and I was like, what's that all about? And then I heard about this bedside educator, so I actually started the story that way, through the bedside educator, just to give you kind of history of it, and then through her met a few of her students and followed two of them for a while, but then did other things as well, I got the first part of the story published, it was actually in the LA Times, but then I kept on the story with Angelica and just had that on my own. It was a hard process, actually, because we became friends, But I wanted her voice to be the one that told the story, I wanted my pictures to tell the story, but I wanted her voice to kind of stream through. And I wondered if you had recorded your parents. You did?
I did. Yeah. Obsessively, I think... And I feel like people can relate, other photojournalists can relate to this, I feel like, yes, I was able to capture a lot of their essence and who they were in the photographs, but I became obsessive about wanting to just record everything.
Yeah.
Everything. So
video
I have
too, or?
Very little video, and that just came from my inexperience with video. I wish I could have done more. The only video, actually, that I have is from, Hanukkah in the hospital. Which was actually pretty funny because we were singing Hanukkah songs and the nurses came in to check my dad's vitals and it was kind of awkward and funny, but a lot of audio.
Yeah, I didn't do any video actually, just audio. And I had recorded the mom, I had recorded the sister, I had done recordings with Angelica, and I had done so many, I was like, I don't even know how to approach this project after the whole thing happened. And when it happened, it was actually, a surprise. I had just seen her, you saw those pictures, and then within a couple of weeks I had seen her again, but she didn't want me to take her picture because she was on some kind of medication that made her bloated, and then I got that call and I was like, wow. So it's kind of jarring because that's how it was for me, but then her mom said, you have to shoot the funeral, and I was like, okay. But I was like you said, we use our cameras as filters, because we're people, right? So you get emotional, and so you have to just kind of pick up your camera and shoot through it, which is what I did. But it, obviously different, my feelings were different than yours, but as a professional, you have to, it's hard to separate yourself sometimes, you know, about what you think is appropriate or not appropriate. And so, like, I was kind of on the sly while I was doing my pictures of the funeral, just like from my own vantage and not like in people's faces and things like that. But they all knew what I was doing, you know. And then after, I had put the project away for at least 6 months, I feel like. And I would look at it once in a while, you know, and then I was like, okay, now I have to edit it. But I had a baby, and I was like, I can't do this.
Oh my
you know?
God, so much life. And
yeah. So it was not easy for me to edit it. And then I was like, okay, now how am I going to stream this? And I left out all the conversations, you know, like everything. And some of my favorite quotes are probably, you know, on the cutting room floor. And some of my favorite pictures, too. But you're also thinking about streaming the story, you know, like how it works together. So it was a hard process, and it took me forever. And I revised it, and I revised it again, and I'll probably revise it again, you know, because everybody who watches thinks, oh, I have this comment, I have this comment, you know, because it's subjective as well, right? It's good art.
But projects were both beautiful and compelling and really kind of hit home with all of your subjects as well. Thank you so much for sharing, Jennifer.
Thanks.
So we're going to move on to a little bit of a lighter subject. climate change, Alaska, and Katie Orlinsky. So Katie, you have been traveling to Alaska for the last 2 years.
Yeah.
You started off with dog sleds, right? And it started to evolve into a little bit of climate change and environmental issues just because you fell in love with the country. You fell in love with the state. And you fell in love with, like, what you were shooting. And I've definitely seen your images evolve. And I was just going to show your images if you just wanted to talk through them.
Sure.
Great. Or just tell a little bit about your project or why you actually ended up in Alaska.
Oh, okay, yeah. So I ended up in Alaska... actually kind of randomly because of an assignment to document a dog sled race, to cover the Yukon Quest 1,000-mile dog sled race, which is this. And I'd never been in this kind of environment, the kind of landscape, the cold, or even that far north. And I pretty much immediately fell in love with it. It's a really inspiring, beautiful place, really fascinating. And so the sled dogs and this dog race was one thing that I really loved and wanted to keep telling the story about, but there was also the whole element of just what cultures are like up in the north. And even just being there for a couple of weeks photographing the race, you could see all of these, everyone was just talking about the weather, everyone's always talking about how much warmer it's getting, what's happening, all of the changes. So I felt like that was sort of just a natural evolution to start working on stories about climate change, because I really enjoyed being in the region and photographing there, and there's just so much happening. So this is a glacier. This is the Herbert Glacier, which is melting away. And this was, I was photographing actually a dog camp up there, but just being in the dog camp, they have to move the camp every 2 days because it's literally sinking. They have to just keep moving it. And so this glacier is rapidly melting. And so go to the next. So I was there actually, I've been working on this long-term project about native subsistence hunting. So in the different villages, hunted foods are incredibly important, and the process of hunting, the safety of doing it, and the animals and their behavior is all changing because of climate change. So in this project, I actually was supposed to be photographing a seal hunt, and it never happened. So for the first time that pretty much anyone can remember, the seal hunt lasted 4 days, and it's normally supposed to last about a month and a half in terms of the behavior of the ice and the animals. So I'm like, all right, so how am I going to tell this story without any seals? But I had been in these two communities, Kotzebue and Point Hope, a month before. And because of this extra fast spring thaw and all of the melting, it was just so stark and so shocking seeing the difference between places from 1 month to the next. So these are all images taken in May and then taken in the exact same place in June. And I had the time to like wander around these towns with my computer, and because I wasn't initially doing this project set out to go to the same spot, I would have somehow GPS marked it. So I had to just sort of like play it by ear and find the same spot, just to sort of illustrate how it was the fastest spring thaw on record in Alaska, and it was the warmest winter on record in Alaska this past year. So these are images of that.
How are the communities feeling with the climate change? And obviously their livelihood is depleting.
It's incredibly complex because the animals are, it's just a big part of culture. And there's already so many challenges to indigenous cultures just because of time and because of, different generations and people moving, and not learning things from the elders. So in addition to that, all of these hunting things have become challenged, and that's a very large issue. But they also, they want industry and they want development and they don't want to be poor. So it's not necessarily that we're talking about people who are environmental activists. They care about animals because they consider themselves stewards of the animals and of their own land, but they also don't really want anyone from the outside telling them what to do about it. They don't want, they don't relate to the people in Seattle on the kayaks. They make fun of them. So it's pretty interesting coming in there as an outsider, someone from New York, because you learn so much, that you don't read in the news.
Mm-hmm. Who are you on assignment for?
So this was, part of it was a personal project, and then I was out there, I was on an assignment for National Geographic News, photographing the seal hunt that never happened. So, but I actually ended up seeing a walrus hunt, and walrus weren't supposed to go to this region during this time period at all, and this was like a pretty special thing to capture and see, but it's just everything's changing so much. And I was also working for The Guardian, but I had a grant from the Pulitzer Center for Crisis Reporting, and I was collaborating with a local Alaskan writer named Julie O'Malley. And so this was a story at the Point Hope Whaling Feast. So it's a whaling village, and they whaling is being challenged because of the sea ice melting. But then every year, 1 month after the feast, they have this big festival, and this is a blanket toss. So it's just really interesting looking at how strong tradition still actually remains in these communities and what's at risk of being lost due to all of these changes with warming weather.
And how are you going to continue the project? I know you're still like kind of right in the middle of it.
Yeah, I'm like smack in the middle of it.
when are you going back?
I have another grant, fortunately, from the IWMF, which is the International Women's Media Foundation. So
excellent.
Thank God, because it's really expensive out there. It's really challenging to work on this stuff. And then just trying to, like, this is a passion project. I kind of break even. I try not to. I try to sort of make a living doing this, but this is something I love. And so when I get out there, I just hustle for assignments so I can spend longer, so I can kind of make the grant money last longer and do as much shooting as I possibly can. It's, all of these places are not accessible by roads. I have to take these teeny tiny little bush planes to get there. So there's a lot of logistics going into just a little shoot. Like there was one photo in there of the polar bears. Like, you go to that polar bear town and you're risking getting stuck there for 3 weeks due to weather. So you basically have to have no jobs lined up if you're going to Alaska for about 4 days because you could just get stuck there.
That's amazing.
Yay!
I bet your gear has changed considerably
definitely.
As well with all the harsh conditions.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for sharing.
That was probably whale, if it was the woman cutting up. Yeah, so that's a village called Point Lay. Yeah, a really isolated village in the Arctic, and they have a subsistence hunt of beluga whale. It's also a bit controversial when you talk about whaling to people because they think, what is this? This is terrible, but it's all regulated. They've been through sort of all the drama with people wanting to stop whaling, and so there's no commercial whaling in the region, but they've been whaling for thousands of years, so they have a limit to how many times they can strike, so how many times they can try to get a whale, and to how many whales they can hunt in a certain time period, and it's quite regulated by Fish and Wildlife. So this was when they caught the beluga whale that comes through in the springtime.
Did you eat it?
I did. I've tried all of it. You have to.
Yeah. Yes.
It's the only thing to eat out there, isn't there?
What?
It's pretty much the only thing to eat out there.
There's other food, but that's also an issue. There really is food security in some of these villages. Grocery store food is very expensive, flying it in. There's not fruits and vegetables. You're in the tundra. So these are important foods. They're important proteins for people.
Proteins,
yeah.
Right.
I bring a lot of power bars, though. I'm not eating only whale.
You whale eater. Thank you so much, Katie, for sharing that. So So we're going to circle back to Jennifer with her celebrity portraits, her corporate portraits, and her notable portraits. Pretty much, Jennifer, you have a variety of work. We were talking earlier about how you hustle from one job to the next, from one assignment to the next. And I was just wondering if you can just discuss a little bit about how you can get so creative with so many different celebrities and so many different corporate people, because your work with your celebrities is completely different from your corporate, even though they're all portraiture. I just want to just a little.
I find that interesting that you think it's so different, but I think it's just the personality type.
Yeah, but you're really bringing the personalities out there, and celebrities are all creative, and they're all like kind of a little bit more dynamic, a little spark in their eye. And the corporate men, you know, they've got money in their eyeballs, and I think you've definitely captured that quite well.
Thanks. Thank you.
So I'm just going to circle through your celebrities, and you can just discuss on how you get so close to these guys, how you become friends with them, how do you emerge with them.
I don't know. I do a lot of portraiture. So for me, I have to challenge myself every time to make it different, because it can become monotonous. And if it is a specialty, and you know, like it is for me sometimes, I like the variety of what I do, you know, as a photojournalist, to go from different kinds of assignments. But when you get a lot of portraiture, you're inevitably going into some random place that you need to light. Like I was saying, like I'll just go into some dark hotel room and have to kind of figure it out. And I like my environment to help give context to who I'm shooting, because it's all part of the story of, you know, what we're doing. But like I was saying before, for me, it's really just about having a good rapport with the subject. And I go into a place, I just think about, you know, what area I want to work in. I kind of let the light lead me in a way where, you know, if I see cool light somewhere, I might want to use it. If I, you know, don't, I'll create that light and I'll think about the space and how it plays off graphically, because I like a lot of graphic composition to my work, but I also like to get the essence of the person, right? So it's kind of a balance of two things. And sometimes I was saying I might direct the subject, but sometimes the subject has no idea what I'm doing, and I'm just talking to the subject and just kind of moving around, and I might be this close to them, like as close as I am to Katie, but they don't feel inhibited by me.
Speak a little bit about your Angelina experience.
Oh, this was, this was my first assignment back from after I had my second kid. And we were just, you know, and I mentioned it to her because I was like, she's like, how are you today? I was like, good, how are you today? And I had heard her talking about, like, she had her kids at the zoo and all these other places. And I was like, oh, I just, you know, this is my first job back. And she, you know, where were you? I was like, oh, I just had a baby, you know. And it was fun. I mean, we had a really good rapport. And I find, like I said, she was so lovely. But most of these people are pretty nice. And then the ones who you think are not, who are going to be the nice ones are not the nice ones. And the ones who you think are going to be the bad ones are the wonderful ones. But I try and, you know, like this picture, for example, I try and think outside the box, because you know you can go into any situation and light the person and you know come up with this product the same, you know, every time. But you know, when you, I'll use all the lenses in my bag and I'll light it a different way and I'll think about it a different way so that I can use the artistic part of myself and the intellectual part of myself and the human part. So hopefully, you know, I capture the essence of people, but I think the graphicness plays off of that and allows you to know what to focus on, because us as photojournalists use our cameras to guide the viewer to what's important to see. But like this shot, you know, maybe that's Andy Cohen from Bravo. You know, of course I do the standard portrait that my editor might want, but then I just like to do what I like to do and think about it, you know, in a different realm. So I hope it comes through. And, you know, for all these people, right, you know, if I'd be lucky if I get 15 minutes with somebody, you know, this is all pulling them out in just a couple of minutes. So I have to be on my game.
And you don't have assistants?
Yeah, most of the time I don't have, when I work for newspapers, I don't have assistants because I don't want to pay for it. When I work for magazines, I can. But a lot of the times I don't, because it's, I just like to know what I like to do and control it. And then, you know, corporate stuff is
sometimes I'll have an assistant and sometimes I won't as well. So really, I just light it all on my own. It's all, you know, years of figuring it out and knowing how to, you know, make it look good, but also get their essence, which is like their truth, you know, because you do so much portraiture, right? Like, where's the story, you know, but there's a story behind each person. So, you know, and I don't usually know anything about these people either. Like, I'll like Google them 10 minutes before I go in and be like, what are they working on? You know, where'd they grow up? So, you know, do they have kids or, you know, just some random fact I might bring up during conversation. But the corporate stuff, which you haven't got to yet, I also treat them the same way. You know, like you're doing the CEO of a company, but they're just, you know, they might think highly of themselves, but they're just regular people as well, right?
Mm-hmm. What was your hardest celebrity to shoot?
I don't know. I don't know, actually. There's so... You know, like the hardest is when you have 2 minutes, right? Like from that batch that you saw, there was a picture of Daniel Craig, the Bond guy, and I literally had 2 minutes with him, like counting 2 minutes. Like I looked at my little clock, you know, and I was like 1 minute and 48 seconds. And I like did this shot with him and then like ran into the bathroom with him and I was like, let's do this, you know, and then... You know, got a few scenarios out of it in a quick amount of time because I kind of pre-think it too, but then I work organically too and I kind of perfect my vision and keep it going and keep it going until I know when I have it and then I can move past it, you know.
What was Jay-Z like?
You know, I like him a lot, actually. We've done 4 portrait sessions together and I feel like... you know, we kind of know each other now, even though it's a brief amount of time, but we know that we'll see each other again, you know? And so every time I feel like I have to recreate a different portrait with him, but the first time I shot him, he did not show up to his own shoot because he was like young. We were both young and, you know, he was like kind of at the beginning of his career and he was smoking pot with his friends in his studio and like couldn't make it to his shoot. After it was all set up and everything. And then I was like, okay, I'm coming back tomorrow. You know, you have to like do this. So we had a good shoot. And then every time after, it's kind of interesting because I've seen him grow up in a way like, you know, he's become a businessman and we'll do something, you know, we did something in his club or whatever. And then, you know, on a set of something. And then he has kids and, you know, got married. So each time he's become more and more professional as a person. And like grown up, which is kind of cool to see, you know, because we're probably almost the same age, you know. I'm younger, of course, but like, you know, so it's, yeah, I liked him.
So I want to circle back to one notable man that you shot. You have a pretty good story about it, Mr. Donald Trump's son.
Oh, yeah. Well, I actually liked him. I know his dad is getting bad press right now. But he was a really nice guy. And I was, you know, he's like, well, what do you want to do? And I was like, I don't know. Let's go to the roof of that building that you're building, you know. And he's like, yeah, you want to go up? And I was like, yeah, okay. But so this is probably, I can't remember if it was like the 27th or 37th floor of the hotel, like in Soho. And, I was probably like 7 or 8 months pregnant and like we got up to an elevator part and then he's like, we have to walk the rest of it. And I was like, okay, I can do it. And like, we're like scaling the side of the building. And after I was like, my husband is not going to like that because you're carrying 50 pounds on your back, like going up some tiny little scaffolding, like that's not safe, you know? But it was good. It was worth the picture. I like it, you know?
Do anything to get the shot, right?
Yeah, of course. Of course. Lie down in the middle of the street for shots, right?
Yeah.
How long were you shooting until you had your baby?
Both times 3 days before. Yeah.
Tough cookie.
Yeah. Yeah, both times. And I and it was only because I was early. I would have worked more probably. But yeah. I mean, you can do anything that you... My kids are 4 and 7 now, so it's a little easier in a way, but harder too because you have to juggle schedules and all that kind of thing. But it's very worth it, obviously. Another job, right? The best job.
Definitely.
Sure.
We're looking at your notables right now, your portraits of semi-famous people or very important people in this industry. And you wanted to talk about a little bit about these guys?
These are, like, I call them notables because they're just from various sub, you know, stories that I've worked on or portraits that I've gotten. Like, that's a spoken word artist and, you know, there's actresses, authors, you know, people who've been wrongly imprisoned or a soldier who, you know, who was amputated. But I like the subtlety of that picture, actually. They're just stories that speak to me, basically. So I call them notables.
I just wonder how you can capture all of these people and make them so beautiful and we don't even know the story of behind them.
Well, yeah, I mean, I hope that each, like, you know, our goal as photojournalists is to do one picture that sums up the whole story, right? So I think if you can do that in a portrait, it's kind of cool to challenge yourself in that way. And, you know, we're not all getting, like, the coolest features to work on all the time. You know, the Angelica project was a personal project of mine. And, you know, I do work on cool stories, though, I have to say, and I've done it all, basically. But, you know, I used to cover politics and everything and travel around all the time. But when you are based here and, you know, I can travel still, of course, but I used to travel a ton. And now, you know, I travel less. So when I do these kind of pictures, I really want to make them insightful. Like that picture was at 5 o'clock in the morning, lying on my back in the studio, looking at a teleprompter, but from underneath, like, you know. That was early morning.
Our job definitely gives us long days sometimes, right?
We never have a schedule, right?
Staying in the snowstorms in Alaska.
Yeah.
Or New York. Thanks so much for sharing, Jennifer.
Thanks.
We're going to move to Nancy. Nancy, we have a great story that you made from Newsday. We're just going to talk a little bit how you got the shot and how you were probably the only one to get this portrait. More so because of you and who you are as a person and how you are as a photojournalist. I just want to give the audience just a little bit of background. You've obviously heard a lot of different stories today, but a lot of it comes from empathy and generosity and time and patience. And this is a really good story to talk about.
Thanks. So as a photographer, it's hard, but like these aren't like my best photographs, so it was like hard to put them up. But this story was important to me, because I was sent on assignment for Newsday out to I think it was Dix Hills. There had been a big fire and a home. It didn't burn down, but the entire inside burned, and I was sent to do a portrait of the family because everyone survived, and so it was a happy story. There had been a lot of fires around that time, and a lot of tragedy. So there was some light, and by the time I got out there, I was probably the last news media to get there, and I met the father. And you could tell he was exhausted. Not only had he been dealing with media all day, but his house was incinerated and he had a lot on his mind. But I kept thinking, you know, like, I can't not get the portrait. How am I going to do this? So I went up to him and I could tell he was really distraught. And actually, a lot of these are just because I didn't know what to shoot. I was getting nervous, so I was taking pictures of details. And a key part of the story was that the family dog had, I think he had smelled the burning and woke people up. And so the story was kind of about this hero dog right here. So I started talking to this man about his dog. I was like, I heard, you know, the dog was the one that really saved everyone. Tell me more. Tell me about the dog. And he's like, I think he even said, like, well, at first the dog, he like didn't necessarily want the dog, but his kids did. And we talked about dogs for about 2 hours. I remember calling my editor being like, okay, when do you need this picture by? And they're like, latest 4 o'clock. And I think it was like 11 or 12. And I was like, okay. So I started to talk to him, and really at that point, no other news had showed up, which was lucky because I really had him to myself. And I knew he was stressed, and I thought if we talk about the dog, that, you know, like that's something I have a dog, you know, I have a dog. I could connect with him on that, and just help him process what had been going on or what had gone on, because he had a lot on his mind. At some point, about, you know, 2 hours in, I was like, look, to be honest with you, like, I don't know how I would be in this situation right now, but the Newsday wants a portrait of your family, because, you know, in the end, like, you all survived, and that's an amazing thing, because that's what's important, you know. And I told him about my family, and we really connected. And I was like, but I understand if this is, you know, like, if this is too devastating for you, but I also want to tell you that, you know, people will connect when they hear about your story and they see your story, and I think something good can come from it. And he's like, okay, well, you know, like, I don't want to, the kids, their clothing smells like smoke, and they're not going to want to come back here. And I just don't know. And I was like, okay, you know, like, I wasn't pushing it. So he was like, you know what, let me call my daughters, and if they want to do it, we'll do it, but we have to figure out another location. And at this point, it started raining, and I was like, oh gosh, like, where are we going to do this portrait if it happens? So he got on speakerphone and called his daughters, and he was like, do you guys, like, want to be on the cover of Newsday? And they, 11-year-old girls, were like, yes, like, ah. He was like, fine. And he was like, you need to find a place for us to go, and, like, give me a time and we'll do it. And even though he had told me that, I was like, there's a chance that, like, they're not going to show up. Like, there's always a chance that it doesn't, unless you're in control really of everything. The only place I could actually find that we could do this was the playground, of the elementary school. They didn't want to be in their, they didn't want to have association. They didn't want to be in front, certainly not in front of the house that burned. And I was willing to take anything. So we got to the playground, and I wish I had been, like, a little bit more thoughtful and creative about it. I was just, like, so desperate to get, because I think we took this picture at, like, 3:45, and I was like, oh, crap, I have to, like, shoot this, caption it, get it, find, I didn't have a Wi-Fi hotspot at that point, and I had to find internet, oh my gosh, on Long Island. Like, I wasn't in the city where there's a Starbucks in every corner. And so we successfully got this. I took this picture. I sent it in. It didn't make the cover. It was too late. But it made the second or third page. And a few days later, I got a call from the guy. And he was like, you know, I just want to thank you for talking with me and for being so kind. And I want to let you know that since the story came out this morning, I've been getting flooded with calls from friends, from strangers, people sending us money, a man offering his trailer for 3 weeks or 3 months, I think it was. And I'm so grateful, because I have, you know, kids and a family, and I don't know what we're going to do, but, like, this is a first, you know, like, a first step. And that was really, it had such an impact on me, because, again, that was like, I believe in what we do and the power of what photographs can do, and to be able to be a part of that story and to stand by, you know, I persevered, which is hard sometimes, but also to hear what had happened was amazing. Unfortunately, I remember he contacted me a couple of years later, like, Hurricane Sandy also damaged his home, and I was trying to, he was like, is there anyone at Newsday I could talk to? Like, I was trying to help, and it's so hard. Like, when you're really, like, I could help by taking the photograph, like, there, and that was able to help, in a meaningful way. But beyond that, there's, you know, little I can do. So anyway, that's,
thank you so much for sharing the impact of a photo.
Yes.
Absolutely.
You know, I just wanted to say, is this working?
Yep.
Good. This moment of this family that she got is one of the most precious moments that you have. Is, you know, this is an award to us. This makes us feel so precious, because we capture their trust. They trust us for this, and we can get into their life for that moment, and that makes our job so beautiful, and that is what I love to do.
So we're going to move to Katie again. We're going to talk about your Nepal and living in Mexico as well. We're going to start with these images, the Nepal, and then we'll just move over to the women's prison.
Sure. Okay, so this is a story about
trafficking in Nepal, so trafficking of women and girls. So yeah, it's a huge issue in the country. They have the I guess the largest open border from one country to another between Nepal and India, and you know, life-threatening poverty and just sort of a complete societal devaluation of women. So there's a lot of issues where, for one, women and girls don't go to school, they don't have jobs, and they're not really valued. And then, do you mind if we pause it?
Oh yeah.
Okay. And then in addition to that, they get preyed upon because they try to go work abroad. They try to work in different Gulf states, or they try to go work in Hong Kong, and they end up basically just getting drugged and sent to India. Sometimes they get found in rural areas and kidnapped. So the first image was of a group of girls in a neighborhood that is just really susceptible to this. Everybody in this village knows somebody who's been stolen or been tricked and trafficked. So that's what I wanted to show. So this is the border area, and there's a lot of activism going on now because the generation of women who have been rescued from trafficking are now activists fighting it. So I was here working with a nonprofit organization that helps these groups of formerly trafficked women fight trafficking and stop trafficking. So they do a lot of really great work along the border with India. So, and this is a... they have local police that stop suspicious looking rickshaws. But the thing is, it's sort of, you know, it's crime. So if they start figuring out that people are using fake ambulances to cross the border, because it's an open border, they're going to stop using the fake ambulances. They're going to figure something else out. So what they really need is a lot of connection with the formerly trafficked women and girls to figure out how they were trafficked, so they can start fighting it. And there's a big stigma when that happens to you, and people don't want to come forward. So that's a challenge.
How long were you on this for?
This I've gone back a couple times. So I went once, maybe about 4 years ago, and then I went again about a couple years later.
How much has it changed since the two visits?
I was really impressed with the organization that I was working with and how much stronger they've gotten. The woman who runs the organization had won a hero award from Hillary Clinton when she was Secretary of State. So
that's great.
Yeah, it was pretty. I was really impressed with the work that they're doing, but it's still a huge issue. So it's not going away. But so those two girls were rescued. So they were kind of tricked into leaving home, and they want to leave home because it's for most families it's really hard to be a girl, and you don't get to go to school, you're not treated well, you're going to get basically sold in the form of dowry for getting married. So they want an escape. So they had been tricked, but they had been rescued by some local activists who figured out that the men that they were with were actually going to sell them as prostitutes. And this is a school, pretty overcrowded. And they also do work about domestic violence and violence against women, because that's just sort of a part of the whole system that is going on there. And so, yeah, so this is proof that she was being beaten by her husband, because of the dowry system, you're sort of seen as property. So to leave a man is not simple at all. It's not, it's really frowned upon, and people won't take you in. Your family probably won't take you back in. And then within Kathmandu, they have sort of like a underground dancing club, sex industry. Prostitution is actually illegal in Nepal, and it's not illegal in India, but they have these kind of like murky massage parlors, dancing clubs, where they recruit girls from rural areas and bring them in.
Forgive me if anyone asked this before, but how do you guys in general work with that minor issue of making a living and handling expense costs when trying to do wonderful work like this that may not be the most profitable revenue stream in the world? And anyone can answer.
Well, I can answer for this project, which is, you know, part of it was actually, I was working with an NGO, so I was able to get, you know, my plane tickets. A lot of the NGO photos I make, they're not a part of this, because they're not images that, you know, they're images that I'm making on an assignment that aren't necessarily illustrating this story. But then, you know, I'll take advantage of the flight out there And I don't imagine I'm really going to make the kind of money that you might from, you know, local New York City assignments doing this.
Yeah.
But eventually with these projects, I feel like if you're passionate enough, they do, like, a year later, it ended up running in the New York Times Week in Review and then running in magazines all over. So
through an agency?
Through having people having had seen it in the New York Times. So it ended up actually, I did, you know, make money, even though that wasn't the intention. I don't know.
It's pretty legit.
Okay.
We're going to move to your Mexico series, too. The women's prison.
One other thing, though. Like, you know, being a photojournalist, as you know, is labor of love, right? You know, editorial photography is a tough way to make a living, but that's why you have to hustle, you know, as you've always been doing that as well. So we all have to wear many hats and, you know, when you're freelance, you have to spread yourself out a bit and have consistent clients and, you know, keep those relationships and, you know, so that you can make a living. But it is a hard way to make a living, but if you're invested in it and you love it every day, then it's worth it.
Definitely work 6-7 days a week on every week.
You can be working all the time, 2 o'clock in the morning, sit in front of your computer, editing, you know.
You kind of have to be like a one-woman show.
Yeah, I like to call myself a one-man band. Like when I walk into a shoot with, like, you know, 50-pound knapsack, 100 pounds of lights, and I'll be like, I'll be ready in 15 minutes, you know, so.
You don't have a producer and a couple of assistants and a stylist with you?
It's all me, you know. Yeah.
Let's discuss Katie's Mexico.
Oh, sure. Yeah. So this is a project. I actually lived in Mexico for almost 5 years, and I left Mexico in 2008, right when the drug war was really starting to kind of take off,
and started freelancing for the New York Times and doing kind of local work in New York, and I kept watching what was happening from afar, and, you know, seeing it in this awful tragedy in this country that I really love and know very well, but I also wasn't seeing anybody kind of documenting half of the country. People weren't telling stories of women throughout this war. There was this narrative that was like, it's criminals killing criminals, it's these, you know, it's these bad guys killing these bad guys. And that really wasn't the case. There were a lot of people caught in the crosshairs, there were a lot of innocent victims, families of people involved. So that's the project that I set out to do in 2010, and I worked on it for like 3 or 4 years.
And how many times have you gone back since then?
I can't count.
Almost 2 times, 3 times a year?
Oh, yeah, at least. Yeah, because I'll also do assignment work out there. And during this time period, so this is in Acapulco, so I tried to focus on sort of the drug war hotspots during this time period, which were Juarez and Acapulco, different various cities, and then also some different border towns. Yeah, so just, this is a woman who was working in the maquilas, and that was... that's kind of a big issue in Juarez because it's really dangerous. There's a lot of women who are really susceptible to being murdered or just being... What is the mystery of the missing women of Juarez? I can't tell you. There's so many theories, but I think, I guess kind of the overarching one is just like they're really, really vulnerable. They're just incredibly vulnerable women who are in the middle of this place, and they're not being taken care of, and that there's also a lot of gang activity going on with the buses. So the buses that were actually driving the women to work were being run by cartels. Yeah, and it's, you know, it's really dark and kind of a mystery, and I think they want to keep it that way. But then, so I found, so you can go back to the last one, and so these are, so I found women whose husbands had been killed, and it was pretty challenging, especially if you're going to a crime scene. People aren't going to want to really have their picture taken after the fact. Sometimes they did. Sometimes I would just go through the local paper and see what murders had to happen that day. There'd be like 10 a day, and contact the families. And some of them really wanted to get their story out because of that government narrative that, oh, if they were killed, they're a criminal. And they wanted to say, no, my husband was a good man, and tell their story. And I also went to some support groups. And then at the end, I'd like hand out a card and be like, call me if you want to tell your story. So it took a lot of time. I'd spend weeks not shooting, but then would find subjects. And so this is one of them with her family.
How free were you to, like, in the streets of a place like that, just to walk around, like, shooting?
You're not. No,
that's
you.
Not going to happen.
No, you work. I mean, in certain neighborhoods during this time period, during 2010, you weren't. You worked with a local fixer, local press people who really knew what they were doing, and even then, you know, you're kind of in and out. You get out and you make the pictures you need to make, and you move.
Right.
You don't stay anywhere too long.
You cannot be like Gary Winogranding out there at all. Not going to happen.
No.
Okay. Is it the border of El Paso?
Yes, right on the border of El Paso, which is actually the safest city in America. So, yeah.
That's ironic.
So, yeah, just kind of documenting daily life in the neighborhoods that were really affected by the drug war. And this is in Michoacan during Day of the Dead. And in that plaza, there had been an 80-person massacre the year before. And also, it was just really kind of powerful to watch how people go on. I mean, it's... Everyone's like, well, why are you still there? Because it's your home and it's your country, and it's not that easy to just pick up and go. So how people were sort of living within this situation was something that really fascinated me.
That's great.
Do they go back and forth to El Paso sometimes?
Yeah, and so fortunately some of the kids can go to school in El Paso, and some people can work, and they have, but it's Juarez and El Paso have kind of been one big city since forever, so it's not that... People don't want to leave. You know, it's not that easy. But the lucky ones during this time period did get to leave.
I know there is strong border control.
Yeah, definitely. But they have passes for students to go to cross the bridge and go to high school in the U.S. And a lot of people are U.S. citizens and Mexican citizens that live in that region. So then another thing that was going on was that women were becoming more and more involved in crime. And some of them were, you know, guilty criminals and murderers, and some of them were just in the wrong place at the wrong time, or, you know, they couldn't really stop it. It was a part of their family. So I wanted to look at that, but I didn't actually really want to photograph gangs. I didn't really care about, like, what these thug guys were up to. I didn't want to take their picture. I wanted to see what was happening for women, but so kind of the place to find them was the prison. And it was these two that started the idea, because one of them was a model, and her story became sort of like a viral sensation. And they had these photos of her in a sexy dress holding a machine gun. And she had been arrested for kidnapping along with her sister. So, so I met them and kind of listened to all of these different women who were in the prison stories. And every single one of them claims that they're innocent and had, and I don't know if they were lying or not, but a lot of them had really did seem to be like they were victims of their situation, if anything.
Great. Thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you.
So I think we're about to wrap it up. We're a little short on time, but I just wanted to give Robert a thank you for hosting us tonight. We could also check the YouTube/Photo Brigade for watching this more and later. Subscribe to us. So if you have any questions for the panel, we'll be more than happy to take them for you.
I was always wondering if one of your celebrities, for example, or anybody, say, just get out of my way. Beat it.
I had a situation. I was sent to the Bill Clinton's initiation, you know, the Sheraton Hotel that he does annually, the meeting with the politicians. And it was many years ago when they said to me, get Brad Pitt. I'm like, okay, get Brad Pitt. He was there with Angelina Jolie. And I tried to find them, you know, floor is up and floor is down. We have press passes, so we're allowed to be in there. And I found Brad Pitt, but he saw my camera, me running after him, and he just waved his hand and said, get lost. I'm like, but hello, I'm sorry, Mr. Pitt, I'm so sorry, please, one picture for the New York Post, just one. Thanks for asking. I pose for you for 2 minutes. That's how that turned out. So, you know, you never know what's going to happen or not, but that's one of the celebrities that I had. And there was one funny story about Monica Lewinsky when the Bill Clinton story broke. We chased her down in Manhattan at the hotel, and she ran away from me, and I ran after her for a block and a half. And I said, Monica, it's okay, whatever, you know, we just want to have a photo of you showing that you're okay. It's just one picture. Just give me a little smile. I don't have to really, you know. No, leave me alone, leave me alone. So it took me 3 blocks, and she ran into a doorway of some alley. And I said, please, just one photo. Seriously, I'm going to leave you alone after that. I understand where you're coming from. Okay, one shot. And I got the shot. But, you know, those are the struggles and fights. And you have to have compassion and passion and patience and the love for that and be motivated and not give up. Don't give up too early. Always just fight for that photo and try to be ethical. you know, and the way you feel it, and it works out. But yeah, celebrities are never easy, especially if you stake them out.
That's the other side, actually, and I'm I don't usually have that experience, fortunately, but Brigitte is a good hustler, so I mean, for sure. Yeah.
So you're all now well established and published in the beginning, and if you had a personal story, do you have any suggestions about how to begin?
I'm just going to tell you how I began. I moved from Los Angeles to New York, and I had no idea what I was doing here. And everybody stepped on my feet, and I'm like, I can't handle this. Too many people here, you know. Los Angeles is so much nicer and wider, and there's parking everywhere. But I landed here for some personal reasons, and I just started calling every single newspaper in New York, and I just asked them to give me a minute to show them my portfolio. And I had the New York Post that invited me up there the next day to show them my portfolio from some pictures that I'd done. In Los Angeles, I was a U.S. correspondent for Vienna, Austria. I did a couple of celebrities here and there, you know, like Patrick Swayze, who was a wonderful man, by the way, but didn't make enough living. But I had some pictures together. So I showed it to the New York Post, and one of the photo editors was my mentor. He gave me a chance. I didn't really have a lot of news pictures. You know, I had a fire from L.A., O.J. Simpson's real estate when he allegedly did the crime that he'd committed, I don't know. But he gave me a chance. You know, you have to fight. You have to be your own advocate. Just fight and try to get these people to give you a minute. Show them a couple of photos or whatever you love to shoot. And if you find somebody who reads you the right way, then he will give you a chance. And a week later, I got taking snow pictures in Central Park. And my first assignment that it was, the next day I had 5 pictures in the paper. In the New York Post, that I still have to this day. I don't, you know, I just started collecting my pictures. I was so proud of it, to fight my way through this. And then you just go out there, you listen to the other, you know, to your colleagues, to the seniors. You just ask them every question in the world, and you just listen to them, and you listen to your photo editors, because they know what's supposed to be done out there. And that's how you work your way through one by one. And every day you do a photo, you know, you're proud of it. And you're only as good as your last picture. And that's how you move forward, and it's beautiful.
I bet you photographed that snow like it was the most important assignment of your life.
You take it very serious because that's where your love is, absolutely.
Yeah, my very first newspaper assignment was of a hotel, and when I showed up, it was like they were making a catalog of the hotels for the newspaper, and the one they sent me to was. It was like pretty run down, and I don't even think they realized it, and. And I walked in there and was like, okay, I've never photographed a hotel before, but I certainly wasn't going to say no to the opportunity. And I photographed the crap out of that hotel. I just did everything I possibly could. Like it was, I mean, if you get a chance, you do the best job you can do. And I also think that it's important. I mean, personally for me, I try to say yes to any opportunity to shoot. Even if it's not what I normally do, I think each situation can be like another tool in your tool belt. Like I shoot weddings now, and I've learned a lot that I apply to my other work. But I think also starting out, what was helpful for me was sort of not being at home sulking about how I didn't know how to get work, and I would just go out and go to photo events and look at other work and meet people and just talk about photography. And you never know who you're going to meet and who, and also I was learning about other people's stories and thinking about what was important to me and the kind of stories I'd want to tell, so that when the opportunity arose that I could, you know, be in the space with, you know, an editor, I actually had something to share.
Any more questions?
This is sort of, I mean, it can be open to everyone, but it's directed a little bit towards Jennifer. I'm really interested in how you have both like the crime scene assignment, but then you also have your portraiture. And in a lot of moments, it feels like assignments I get, it's like you get pinholed sometimes. So how have you been able to balance both and sort of get called for both of those sort of like ends of the spectrum?
When I first started out, I started out as a news photographer, or like a more generalist kind of photographer. And I, like I was saying before, I love that variety. But I also think it's really important to be well-rounded in all parts because all your skills translate. When I do a portrait, I'm thinking fast and I'm doing the same kind of things as I am doing on a news scene. I'm thinking compositionally, I'm thinking about the emotion, I'm thinking about everything, you know? But it's true that that editors like to pigeonhole you, kind of, in a way, because when they know that you're good at portraiture, then I might just get portraits assignments from one editor, you know? And then I kind of have to go back and be like, oh, I want to do, can I do that kind of work for you? Or, you know, think about me this way. Because when you show your book around, let's say, where now everything's on the web, right? Like, if I'm going to a magazine, maybe they want to just see portraiture, but then I'm like, wait, but I could also do this. And then they're like, wait, I don't even know how to think about you now. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you know? And that's kind of hard because I don't want to be pigeonholed, right. But at the same time, I know what I like to do and what I'm good at, and I just try and be good at everything equally right. So that I can go back and forth to those worlds because it's what I like to do. But it took a long time to learn that and move both ways, mm-hmm. and most people don't do that seamlessly. Mm-hmm. But it also depends on the longevity of your clients. Okay. So, you know, I've been working, let's say, with the Times for almost 15 years, so a lot of those editors know that I'm versatile, yeah. You know. But it depends what you know, like if I go to one client, I might just show them one kind of thing, and if I go to another client, I might show them another right. kind. But, you know, it's important just to be strong all around, I think.
Okay, great.
You know.
But, and one more thing is I also think if there's something you want to be shooting and you're not because you're just not getting those assignments, then you have to do it on your own.
Right.
So you've got that work there, and then eventually they'll see it somehow and know you can do it, but it is hard because editors just sort of, you know, they're thinking fast too, and they just want to send who they know can do this one thing, so they're not going to think of you necessarily. So, but if there's some big thing that you want to start doing, then you'll just have to kind of do it on your own.
Okay, great.
And I also think if you show that you are good in one kind of assignment, it translates into different kinds. Like if you're good on a news feature, for example, and you make that feature become a personal kind of view to somebody, then they'll be like, oh, that person can be a feature photographer, and I'll send them on some cool features. And then that'll lead to kind of portraiture, and then because you're getting more in depth with the one character. And so it all kind of moves into, you know, this peak, and, you know, you just have to keep on going with it every day, and
also
be
with
the best.
That, the photo editing part for photo editors is myself being a photo editor. Just keep calling us, you know, harass us. It's really, you know, like if you're good about it and if you have the work and you keep pushing it, and then we'll look at it. We'll eventually click, and then but you just have to be persistent, but not desperate. You just really want to make sure that you're confident in your work, and we'll see it eventually.
Start with this one. Is that a mistake? Start with that. And then it all falls
a little bit, yeah. That's a red flag.
I'm curious. Were you ever, any of you were interested or ever went to a war zone to take photos there?
I think everybody has.
Well, 9/11 was like a war zone here. And after that, I had always thought that I would want to do that kind of work. And when I started out, I thought I would be like the international photojournalist going to war zones. And then after that, I was like, I don't need to do that. You know, I prefer to, you know, I followed that story for 10 years, right? So I felt like I had done that, and I wanted to do other things as well. So, I mean, I think for all of us, it's probably, you know, something that we weigh in our heads. But then also, you know, as you go through your life, you know, do you have a family? Do you have, there's so many other responsibilities that come in. So it's not easy to just take off all the time like that. And when you do war zones, you're usually, you know, you're trained for it. You specialize. Some women photojournalists that I know really specialize in that. And it's amazing work, you know, but it does take a toll on other things, you know, doing war kind of stories.
It's also that times changed and press photographers are targeted now in specific areas in this world, you know, in wars. So that's another suspect and subject where you have to think about if you really want to give yourself into this, because you have to be really careful. You have to be with a translator. You have to be prepared. But I guess you can't be prepared enough if you are targeted with a camera, because you capture that moment that nobody over there wants you to transmit. So that's another one.
Thank you so much, ladies, for joining me tonight.
And thank you everyone for coming. And please check out photobrigade.com/live and subscribe to us on YouTube.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.